from the great heart to begin with, and beautiful food. And if I have a request before I say anything about the mega quarry, please, Catherine, be kind to me. Don't make the Highlands Company's application known as Carl's case. Got that one out of the way. I'm always humbled by how many people and groups are involved in this issue. And two things come to mind. The mega quarry case, somehow, the proposal seems to be the lightning rod that finds ways to attract all kinds of important issues, from local food to preservation of farmland to water issues, and how this one application has combined so many concerns and has put some solutions right at our fingertips. Case in point, if we can, through the Aggregate Resources Act review, focus some attention at government and bureaucratic level to protect prime farmland from industrial excavation, we have solved the source water issue that is connected to this. You guys are all familiar with the numbers, and I don't have to, you know, tell you those. A real key for us is to ask questions that we know we can solicit a yes from. You know, that's a really interesting sort of approach to lobbying. And there's a unique opportunity centered around this proposal, and that is because of so many bright people engaged in this, we got to this before the license was ever granted. Most popular movements that you see happen, they happen because a license has already been granted to do something, and now we're taking opposition with someone else's position. In the mega quarry case, so far, it's following the rules, government is following the rules of a proposal, and we have some real influence on the decision making. In other words, you don't have to go to a minister and say, you made a mistake granting the license. That's a really, you know, if you think about how you solve problems, if you have to get the decision maker to admit he made a wrong decision, that's way harder than influencing the original decision. So we're really fortunate to be in the game where we're in. And I appreciate, and it's one of my most humbling experiences, on how many people and groups are involved, and I always struggle in finding ways to say thank you, because you're sure going to miss someone. It'd likely take me 24 hours to walk through a list of people that I know who have given so generously in this 100% volunteer effort, taken the Baupost hedge fund, known, and I can say this now legally, referred to in a New York courtroom as a vulture fund by a lawyer, so I'm just reporting. Boy, this is, you know. We're going to take them absolutely to task with their proposal. So let me tell you quickly about the ARA review, and I'm jumping myself. When I think about all the groups involved, one of the challenges NDACT is facing is to keep our messaging very simple. So we're happy to serve and help disseminate information from other groups that we're working with because they help us do the same thing. We're not going to take a stand really on a whole lot of issues other than in a very quiet way. And an example for that is Stomp the Mega Quarry. I have some cards here for our July 28th. Big public event. Nestle came on board and wanted to be the lead sponsor.
That's funny. Was it John?
Goosebumps thinking about that decision.
Was it
it's
John?
It's not easy when you're trying to raise money to turn down 50 grand, you know. But in solidarity with the folks in Guelph, that's absolutely the only decision NDAC could make, and we did. So
Was it John Challoner?
I'm not going to get into names. Oh, you're see. Reporting me. You're really careful here. So the point is, we work in solidarity on many things, I would caution in whatever people are working on to keep your name and association fairly narrow in focus so that bureaucrats and politicians, when they hear your name, relate you to your mission statement and not start to associate you with just a group who carries everybody's banner, because it just discounts the ability of you for you to engage. Does that make any sense?
Yeah. Yeah.
So that sort of is really a challenge to us. David Suzuki Foundation, you know, great organization. They help us, and we understand that, and we're grateful. Yet the David Suzuki Foundation will forever stay the David Suzuki Foundation, and NDAC will stay NDAC in how we approach our issues. AIA Earring was a, you're familiar with them, was a real experience, announced on a Friday afternoon to start Monday morning. Standing committee, all-party committee, and government, and people asked me, do you think that was done on purpose? No. No, I mean it, no. When my lovely wife, she comes to me when I'm on one of these rants, and she comes and she makes this motion of taking my glasses off, and the first time I said, honey, what are you doing? She said, I'm taking your rose-colored glasses off. Okay. I still believe in the integrity of people and the process, including bureaucrats and politicians, and I don't want to get off that bandwagon. So I think the process happened in that fashion because the last time the Agri Resources Act was reviewed, there were only two players, government and industry. There was no public engagement.
Exactly.
Now, 20 years later, there's all kinds of public engagement.
Wonderful.
And everyone is looking for solutions. Government is looking for solutions, industry is looking for solutions, and communities are looking for solutions. And it was absolutely remarkable. With such short notice, 80 presentations were made. I read most of them, not all of them, but most of them. And there are a lot of common denominators. Aggregate industry recognizes that the fee they're paying on a tonnage basis, and why would they care, it's just a pass-through cost to them anyway, needs to be significantly different to protect local infrastructure. It's a no-brainer. They know they cannot stay profitable, engage in these 15-year-long fights. They understand that if you apply for a license for local supply, that you shouldn't then go and export it. There's a reason why the proponent here is not James Dick or local St. Mary's or local anybody, but a in a New York courtroom called Vulture Fund out of Boston. So the point I'm making out of all these submissions is likely 7 or 8 things that everybody can agree on. The only reason we have had the hearings to this point is because people have been unbelievably, starting last spring, in demanding better policies. Mm-hmm. And that is what you refer to, in the letter writing campaign that you have helped with, getting the government, first time ever, to put a quarry application to a full environmental assessment, to promise at election time to hold an Aggregate Resource Act review hearing, then actually putting it in a motion. 4 days were tremendous. Normally these sort of things have 2 people watching, Mike Schreiner from the Green Party, and I really like him, who is taking notes on behalf of everyone, and 1 bureaucrat. In this case, it was standing room only. Every day they added 10 chairs and 20 more people showed up. Added 10 chairs and 20 more people showed up. And it cannot be lost on an all-party committee that when it was all said and done, and it was very fortuitous that NDAC was the last presenter and could sort of sum things up, that the gallery of who all was in there, lawyers and everybody, gave a 3-minute standing ovation. You know, like at a government hearing that cannot be lost on the people sitting on the committee. You have helped, you have heard, and then you have helped. You have heard that they weren't going to travel. We wanted them to travel. We as people who live with these policies, we emailed, we pushed, we did, and we prodded, and I don't know if you heard yet, but they are going to go on the road for 4 days. Thank you to the absolutely people power movement. And to me, this whole issue, mega quarry, prime land protection, prime farmland protection, source water protection, is democracy and people power at its very best. We're civil, we're fact-based, we know what we want, and we know what the government can deliver, and we also know what the aggregate industry can deliver. You know, we have these liaisons to build on, and we have these liaisons to drive better policy. So to me, the goal for so many people, be it through water, source water protection, prime farmland, is that through that goal, through better policies, and just doing better business, we all are better off, and life of future generations will be better. So thank you, each and every one of you, the organizations that you represent, the effort that you put in to make this thing happen. Stay tuned, a lot more exciting things on the horizon. One of them is, I brought a bunch of cards. I'm leaving them on the table. See what you can do if you want to come up and walk, bike, or jog around that beautiful area up there. July 28th, join the Honeywood Barbecue. Please register online when you do, because we need to know which food to make.
How many people showed up for the Honeywood Barbecue last year?
The Honeywood Barbecue?
Honeywood is in the middle of nowhere, folks. Wonderful agricultural right. land. You have, no, really, it is. That's where you have beekeepers. And in the middle of this place with so few people, how many people showed up?
Well, that food stock, which is what I think you referred to, where some 28,000 people came. So it challenged all kinds of things. It was just an unbelievable day in October. And I know some of you were there, so I don't want to tell you all the exciting stuff about food stock. There'll never be another food stock because it took everyone by total surprise on how people made a commitment to local food. And we were discussing earlier about local food and the initiatives, which used to be a fringe organization, a fringe thought 25 years ago. Michael Stettlander and Jamie Kennedy, when Michael was at the NECA, does anybody remember that?
Yeah.
You know, so that's when that started to us. And, you know, they were just out there. They are a political movement now with clout, and they're lending their support to some very fundamental issues. Keith Curry from the Ontario Federation at the hearings left us with a great line. And we have all the technology. We have the Hubble Space Telescope, and yet life as we know it depends on 6 inches of topsoil, and we hope that it rains. So thank you very much for continuing to support and for continuing to allow me to come share dinner and bring you up to date on NDAC adventures and misadventures. But I'm sure the website has been extremely helpful, because we have this thing in the bottom right hand corner, and I told you this the last time, where how can I help button kind of deal.
Oh yes.
And when we ask, and we ask for help after the committee was told no, we can't travel, and lo and behold, the House leaders changed their mind and passed the permission that they travel. It was only because they got thousands of emails saying this is the wrong thing, these guys got to go. And
there
that's
you
not
go.
A politician doing that, so you guys do it.
That's
you
it know?
And that's what makes this such a fun ride, but not Carl's case.
Well, good evening. Maybe
good evening
you can
to you.
Just tell me your name.
My name is Carl Kozak, and I'm the chair of NDACT.
Oh, hi. There we go. And there's a little one, very happy about things.
We sure are.
Yes.
Okay, tell me a little bit about what's happening.
Well, on November 21st, the Highland Companies withdrew their application for the proposed mega quarry in the township of Melanctha. And most of your viewers will be familiar with the facts surrounding that.
Yes, of course.
That application.
Yeah. So what is the next step?
Well, for NDACT, ever since our board got formed, we had two missions. One was to stop the mega quarry development. And second to that is do our very best to change the legislation that allowed that application in the first place.
Yeah.
And that would be the Aggregate Resources Act. We have been instrumental in helping to put presentations together during the public review or public commenting period of the ARA review that has all concluded now. And we're equally involved with making sure that the provincial policy statement reflects the wishes of Ontarians to put food and water first.
Right.
And I want to be clear that this is never an argument against aggregate. We all recognize we need aggregate in order to grow our economies and to support our way of life.
Of course.
This argument has been about bad planning, and that's where our thrust of our arguments and our solutions lie.
And of course, you know, when you have an issue, usually everybody learns something from it, and I'm pretty sure a lot of people have. So the future looks a little bit brighter as far as I can see.
Well, bit by bit, and if you measure success not in a matter of a month or two, but in 5 or 10 or even 20 year cycles, a peoples, developed world or otherwise, we're all finding our voices and finding our mechanisms as to how we can drive decisions that work better for the people.
Yeah.
And the mega quarry is a prime example for that. It has to work better for the people.
That's for sure. We definitely need to do something to protect our water.
Yeah, food
well,
and water first.
Thank you very much, Carl Kuza.
Well, Merry Christmas.
And for all the work that you've done, I mean, it's phenomenal.
No.
And I'm pretty sure most Ontarians would thank you.
Well, you know, I often wondered about an outcome, and I thought to myself that the victory for local food and clean water is like a giant puzzle piece on my wall, you know, with
there
a beautiful picture.
Yeah.
And that everyone who did their part, be it a single phone call, be it supporting and carrying a piece of promotional item to highlight the issue, the picture would never be complete without everybody's puzzle piece. So thank you to you for what you're doing. Council of Canadians has been instrumental. Mark has helped us a great deal.
Yes, yes.
And it's just a victory for all of us, for us.
Yep, and there's plenty of issues to keep us going.
You bet, you bet.
All right then, thank you, Carl.
Cheers.